film because My Own Private Idaho had been made, this one can sort of be supported by the prior film. And so I felt like I was able to make a movie that could go in unusual directions or sit, you know, with a character in ways that maybe you wouldn't normally do in a commercial film. Gus had the burden of, while making a, you know, groundbreaking film, he also had to make a film that, you know, people would come see, and, you know, he would make the money back for the investors. And so, in some ways, he had those pressures, which any director, you know, has, whether he or she chooses to, try and be responsible to his investors or not, or pressures of, you know, critical pressures or that kind of thing or not, they're still there. With this project, I didn't have those same kind of pressures, and I could tell a story that in some ways was more oblique, but anybody that knew the original film could, you know, fill in any blanks that they needed to, or that it didn't need to hold together in completely the same way. And so that means that I could focus on the actor, or just let the actor be. And I suppose, you know, part of that also just comes out of my background as an actor, and you know, looking at what I, you know, really just investigating what interested me most about this film, and the other is the original film, and then also, I know it's a long answer, but
it's all good.
You know, one of the main things that I cut out was all the Shakespearean stuff. In Gus's film, My Own Private Idaho, there's a whole section that is inspired by Shakespeare's Henry IV, and particularly Hal and Falstaff relationship that Keanu and this other character named Bob kind of convey. And there's a lot I could say. That came about because Gus originally had three scripts. He'd been trying to write a script about homeless youth since he had graduated from RISD, or when he was living in Hollywood before he made Portland his home. And he would watch kids on Hollywood Boulevard and I guess try and write about them. I don't know if any script from that time exists. And then he hooked up with John Reichy, who wrote City of Night, because Gus just felt like he grew up in like Connecticut and Menlo Park or Menlo Atherton, and you know, that I think was in advertising, and I guess he felt like he was very interested in the subject matter, but he couldn't access it. So for a while, he was going to use John Reichy's book, and then didn't, and then eventually directed a movie called Alice in Hollywood that was never released. Nobody's ever seen. I'm dying to let him, you know, make him show me that. And then he did Malinocci, and then Drugs for Cowboy, and then this. But by the time, you know, that was years later after his initial impulse, and he had three scripts that he'd written about this subject matter, and he cut pieces from each of the scripts and pasted them together, and one of those was this thing inspired by Henry IV. So I don't know this, he's never told me this, but I imagine at that time, in 1990-91, when it came out, this was still very kind of cutting-edge material, and especially, I think this is pretty much the first time that two mainstream straight actors played gay characters, or characters that were having gay sex. And
forgetting Christopher Reeve and Michael Caine in Death Trap.
Okay. Well, there's one. All right, they beat him. So, still one of the early ones. And there's something about the Shakespearean stuff that pushes the movie in a different direction. It kind of pulls you out of it, or take some pressure off Gus, and he can say, well, it was, you know, Shakespeare wrote about it already, so I don't know. And so I felt like he had one movie that was very almost, you know, documentary in feel with the kids in Portland and the way he shot it. It's almost, it was almost like that documentary Streetwise that was about Seattle street kids, about real street kids. And it's almost shot in that way with these interviews and everything. And then he had this whole other kind of movie with the Shakespearean stuff. And so I thought, well, I'll just focus on the one kind of, you know, the filmmaking, and leave that other stuff for a different project, and focus on two of the early versions, two out of the three of the early versions.
The interesting thing is that your film is exactly the same running time as his film. They're both like 105 minutes. So you actually replaced, I don't know, I'm guessing roughly maybe 40% of his version with new material. Not just different takes, but scenes that didn't make it into his version. And I think all of the things that he cut out, it's kind of a shame he cut them out, but I guess that there was a balance that he had to strike, and obviously he couldn't do a 2.5-hour movie. But, I mean, I think you've done a real service in uncovering a lot of really incredible material. I mean, just some of those final scenes where he's encountering, you know, some of the other street kids, and they've now kind of got jobs. It gives you much more of a sense of him being left out in the cold than you got in the original one, because the original one ends, he's still part of a community, but in this one, he's really isolated at the end, and that's a huge difference. I mean, one of the things, I think this film is a real great object lesson in how any given movie contains within it a multitude of possible versions of the movie.
Yeah, yeah.
And I mean, I've never really seen it demonstrated so clearly.
Yeah. Well, I'll talk a little bit about how it came about. So, like I said before, I was, you know, just obsessed with the movie, and I asked Gus about it all the time. And when Milk came out, we had a bunch of premieres, one in San Francisco, one in LA, one in New York. And then Gus wanted to do a special premiere in Portland as a fundraiser for a charity for homeless youth. And I guess the other actors were burned out on premieres at that point or something. He couldn't get Sean out there, so he settled for me, and he said, if you come out, I'll give you a tour, an Idaho tour, and we'll go to all the locations where I shot my own private Idaho. And I said, oh, sounds like a dream come true, but I'd love to. So we did the premiere, and then we spent a full day, and he showed me all the locations, and a lot of them are gone. Where, you know, the area, a lot of that's just in downtown Portland, near a park that's still there, but a lot of those places are gone now. But that was actually where he shot it, was actually where traditionally the kids had been, you know. It was a pickup spot called Camp, I guess. That was a name that came from the Depression, where people would camp there, and then the name kind of passed on to the street kids. Anyways, so he gave me a tour, and then at the end of the tour, he said, you know, I have the reel. So then I went back, and we spent 2 days and watched as much of the material as we could. And that, to me, it was like, he said, I have this treasure chest that I've been, you know, it's been in my storage for almost 20 years, and I haven't looked at it. And, you know, River died 2 years after this movie came out, and I think it's his best performance, and he's, you know, one of my favorite actors. And so to be able to see all the raw material and takes of his best, what I consider his best performance, was incredible. And then, not only was it his best performance, the way that River and Gus worked on this film was, you know, so great, because, you know, everyone will say, I've since worked with the DP and the editor of the original film. Eric Edwards was one of the two DPs, and then Chris Clayton was the editor, and they said, you know, River, Gus gave River so much room to just create, and I've seen all, I've seen every minute of it, so I can see that, you know, every take, I saw that every take was different, and was exploring the character, and so... Okay, so then he said, you know, so we're sitting there and watching all these films and all the material, and Gus and I started talking again about it. And there's that scene where Keanu and River are walking down the street, and in my version, they don't really say much. Just kind of walk down the street. River has, like, red tinted glasses on. And we were watching that scene, and Gus was like, oh, look. You could just hold that shot as they walk down to one side and come across and go across the other. And I was like, yeah, you know, it'd be more like your films now, like Elephant or Jerry, you know, where you hold the shots more. And he's like, yeah, I should have just stayed on the shots. And he didn't even put that scene in the original thing. And so then we started, and then he's like, I feel like we should cut this again. And I'm like, yeah, I think we should. but they were all on old film reels, and he said, well, it cost, you know, it could cost up to $100,000 to get this, all these reels digitized. Anyway, I got the project sponsored, and I got somebody to Gucci to pay for it, and it didn't cost $100,000. And so then I asked him if I could do it, and he said yes, and under the condition that if it was bad or he didn't like it, that I would never show anything. So when I was editing it, I just wanted to show everything. I mean, to me, it was like, at this point, 20 years later, every minute of this film, you know, my favorite American filmmaker and my, you know, my favorite actors, every minute, you know, should be seen. And in fact, I did make a, you know, I think there was 25 hours worth of dailies, and I made a 12-hour cut.
I'm going to show that next year.
We showed it. I mean, the first place we showed this was in our gallery, the Gosen Gallery in L.A., and that was important to me because I wanted to really make it clear that this was not supposed to be a commercial enterprise in a theatrical setting. It wasn't supposed to compete with the original, that this was an examination of the material. And we showed it there, and I showed this cut and the 12-hour cut. And we got... Gus had gone to the Phoenixes and talked to Joaquin Phoenix to get permission, or get his blessing to do this. And Joaquin was... okay with it, but then I guess once it became an actuality and we had the show at the Gagosian, understandably Joaquin got uncomfortable and so didn't want, he liked the idea of this cut, but didn't like the idea of the 12-hour cut, and I tried to explain to him that, you know, there was nothing in there that would be embarrassing or shine any kind of negative light on River. But he was still uncomfortable with it, and so I obeyed his wishes, and I took that one down. So I haven't shown that 12-hour one, but that one is interesting in its own way. Where this one, you know, is an unusually structured, but still tells a narrative. Has an arc for the character. The 12-hour one has its own arc, but it's more the arc of the filmmakers. And River's giving a performance here, but, you know, I believe because of the way that Gus allowed him to work and the way they work together, he was able to bring so much of his spirit, whether it's him or not, it's his creative spirit is there in a very raw form. And so... you can see that even more in the 12-hour cut, where you can see multiple takes and see how it changes, you know, how a scene changes from take to take. And then there's stuff in there where after Gus says cut, where the camera still rolls and the sound is still rolling. And one of the most moving things that I saw was that there's a scene in here where they're in Italy, and all the young guys are talking in Italian, and then Keanu picks up River, and they're in a taxi cab for a second, the back of the taxi cab. Well, that was the last shot of the entire shoot. And they shot it in a real taxi in Rome, and Gus, because there was a driver, and then the camera operator was in the shotgun seat, and then the sound man was in the trunk. So there's no room for Gus, so he had to be in a follow car, on walkie-talkie. And so River had to do the slate, so they had the slate down on the ground. And you can see, I've seen this in the take, and I put it in the outtakes, and I put it in 12-hour cut. River, all he has to say is, what did they want? And Keanu will say, I just told them to take care of it until I got back. That's it. That's all they have to do, and they're done with the movie. But River won't say it. He's goofing off. He's doing silly Italian accents. He's making funny faces. And then by like take seven, he's drawing all over the slate, and you can hear the camera like getting mad, like, come on guys, just do this. And like it goes up to like take 15 or something. And you think that, at first glance it seems like, oh, River's just kind of being a brat, or what's the problem? Just do the scene. Gus is on the walkie, I guess. Gus told me later he was on the walkie, like trying to yell at them, getting really pissed. He can't do anything because he's in the other car. And so finally he said it, and then they're like, that's a wrap. And they brought out a cake, and River took the cake, and he went. And Gus's interpretation was that, River didn't want this movie to end. That was the last take. And in hindsight, you look at it and it's like, wow, that was the last take of his best performance of his life. And then he was gone 2 years later. And so, to me, it's a performer, at the peak of his powers, not wanting to let this project go. And I guess I can relate. I can relate to that too. I can relate to a lot of things in this project. So, so that was what was in the 12-hour cut. But anyway, one of the reasons I do hang on, the shots for so long is it's about the performance. It's about sharing this, what I've considered just treasure, that has been uncovered.
Can you single out any particular moment or any particular scene or any particular choice that you see in your version that you really particularly feel was exceptional, that really, really, affected you or had, really moved you? I mean, what's your favorite bit is what I'm saying.
I guess when Gus and I, what pops into my head right now is when Gus and I were watching the day for the first time, there was that scene, just a simple scene, the scene in the grocery store that was not in the original, it's not in my own private Idaho, and it's just River walking through the grocery store. And it looks like, those are real shoppers, they didn't get, they didn't rent out that grocery store to get that shot. They probably just went to the manager and said, alright, we're just going to come in here, two times with the camera, and then we'll be gone. And so it's this great kind of intersection of an actor and the real world, and River's kind of got great energy in there, and I just remember thinking, like, oh my God, I just want that to be in a movie. I just want that scene to be in a movie, mm-hmm. because it's it's River just acting on the fly. That wasn't scripted. They just said, let's go in, you go grab some stuff, you shop, and maybe you pretend you bump into some one of your, you know, Johns, and then buy the stuff and go. And so it was just, to me, it was just such a pure moment, such a pure kind of scene. And so that's, to me, that was one of the things that kind of was in my mind before I even made it.
Yeah, in that scene, when he's kind of having that slight exchange with the checkout girl, you just have this feeling that she sort of recognizes him. And it's really kind of sweet.
Yeah, well, she is really works there, and is kind of put on the spot. And, I mean, you have to imagine there's like a whole camera team like right behind River, and there she is just trying to do her job like naturally, but now there's a big camera there. And that's I think that's cool too. It's somebody in their regular role suddenly in a movie now, and it becomes something different. It becomes part of this other narrative. And,
I just want to mention one other thing, and then I'm going to like turn it over to this horde of people who are about to tear my head off for asking me too many questions. But in Gus Van Sant's version, the moment where River Phoenix really kind of cuts loose emotionally is in the hotel room in Italy, when he does that, where he just has that kind of, he flips out and he's jumping on the bed. That's kind of the most, it seems to be the most emotionally out there that he gets, in a kind of like demonstrative kind of, you know, letting out a lot of pain. In your version, it's the scene with James Russo in the when he goes to see his brother, his father, whatever it is.
Yeah.
I've never seen River Phoenix go any further than that in any performance, in terms of like really putting it out, putting himself on the line, really being fearless. And I'm kind of really curious as to why Gus Van Sant didn't want to have that in the film.
Well, it's really weird, because as you can see, the material is there. River had takes that where he was very emotional in the James Russo scene with the brother. And before I'd seen the dailies, Gus would always tell me, well, that was supposed to be the emotional scene. In Gus's film, it's emotional, but it's not that. You don't see River crying in the original, or at least not in close-up. And Gus always told the story that River felt like he, and these are Gus's words, River felt like he didn't have his River Phoenix moment in that scene. That he, meaning he didn't get it. He was known for being, you know, emotional, I guess, or being, you know, really good with emotion. And he wanted it in that scene, and he felt like he didn't get it. And so that led to the campfire scene in the original, where in mine they're just hugging, but in the original, River's character tells Keanu's character that he, you know, loves him and opens up to him. And the story is that River, like, wrote that scene. That in the original, they just, it was more casual. Like, I guess they just talked about having sex because they were bored. But River, Gus allowed River to rewrite it and make it, you know, the emotional core of that character in my own private item. But that scene is the most revealing, maybe not the most emotional, but the most revealing is, you know, River, Mike says he loves Scott. And that was because he felt like he didn't get the performance in the brother scene, but when I finally got the material and I looked at it, I thought, I don't know what those guys were thinking, because they did get very emotional in it. And he is crying. He did have his River Phoenix moment. I didn't understand why it wasn't in there. And what it could have been is, you know, Gus had another editor. Sometimes, I don't know exactly how Gus and Curtis worked, but I do know that they covered that scene like crazy. There were a ton of takes of that scene and angles. I didn't use half of them in this. it could have been that Curtis just gave him, you know, a cut, and they were like, okay, that, yeah, that works, and maybe Gus didn't go through all the takes. I don't know, but obviously the emotion was there, but for some reason Gus and River didn't think it was there when they shot it. I don't know.
All right, questions out there. At what point did it start to feel like it could be a movie in its own right?
Well, I would say that I was driven, like, you're right, I was driven by this, with this cut, I was driven least by the story, that what was driving me here was River and Gus, and the material that Gus shot, and the performance that River gave. That was what I really wanted to examine. The story, for me, is just something to kind of guide us along. And sometimes I feel like you say, well, when did it become a film? Well, we're only trained to think that films need to be narratives because that's just what makes money. But, you know, a film doesn't necessarily need to be that way, and in fact, sometimes I feel like stories are just kind of strangling other aspects of this movie. Or there's shots I see, like I in a movie where I think, oh, I wish they could just stay on that shot longer, just let that play out a little longer. But they have to kind of like they want to tell certain things, and so this was. A situation where I didn't need to worry about the story as much. But I also didn't feel like I didn't want to just make a mess. Like, I had the 12-hour cut when I was doing this one, so I felt like I didn't need to just kind of lay everything out. Like, I didn't want to, you know, shape it. So I feel like it's, you don't know the guy's, like, looking for his mom at the beginning, or, but... It's you're introduced to a certain way of life. You're introduced to not only River but other street kids or people in that world. And so maybe it's not an immersion in a story, but it is an immersion into a certain kind of atmosphere and way of life.
Maybe back then. All these people in the front row with the questions, yeah. Become available for more people to see it.
Yeah, that's one of the tricky things about this project is there is the original movie, and not only do I not want to kind of compete with the original movie, but New Line also does not want us to compete with their and. So we were able to do this partly because it was going to be, shown in art contexts and goes in PS1 and here. But you're right. I would like to show it more. I am still obsessed with the subject matter. The project has continued since this. These initial, the 12-hour in this cut, Gus gave me two of the original scripts that he had cut up to make My Own Private Idaho, and so then we'll see in the and the insulation over there, we shot one of them that was originally called My Own Private Idaho, but and it had two characters who eventually became River and Keanu's characters, but in this version they were younger and they were Hispanic, and so it sort of came more out of the world of it Gus captured in Malanoche. And so we shot that. We shot his script, his earlier script, on 8mm to make it feel like, not again, we wanted to really emphasize that this is not supposed to be a commercial venture or like a commercial, theatrical commercial adventure, that it's, you know, more of a examination of our project. So we shot it in 8mm. For me, it's almost like, you know, I do a lot of studying and stuff, and you know, there's a certain way to study, as I guess, you know, in school and when you're doing scholarly academic projects. To me, that was almost like a hybrid of filmmaking and scholarly work, where we've uncovered, you know, an original version, but now we're gonna make it. And when you make a film based on somebody's script, you have to answer the questions of like, why did he put that line there? Why this scene? Why is that scene coming for that? What is he trying for here? And so it makes you by making the movie, I feel like we understood the script even more than we would have just by interviewing Gus about, you know, why this, why that. Here, we're going to actually do it. And then we did a sort of similar thing with one of the other scripts, In a Blue Funk, that was the script that depended most on the Shakespearean material. And again, a lot of that material had gone into My Own Private Idaho. That Gus then cut out. There were long scenes with Keanu's character, the Falstaff character. One scene that stands out is in the Henry IV, Hal and Falstaff play act, and they pretend to be the king and Hal, and they switch places. And they actually did that scene in My Own Private Idaho, and Gus cut it out. Mm-hmm. So we used all the material that was in the In a Blue Funk script that Gus had used for My Own Private Idaho, and then filled in the blanks, the scenes that he hadn't shot, and put all those together. And we used Henry Hopper, Dennis Hopper's son, for the mic role, because he had been in Gus's other film Restless, and used a couple of the other actors that had been in the original My Own Private Idaho. And Udo Kier, who plays Hans, is in the other one, Idaho is in the other one. So he reprised his role, which was also fascinating. To see him do that role 20 years later and with different actors. And
I think you were nuts.
No, he has a long history with the art world. You know, he was a Fassbinder actor and did Blood for Dracula, Flesh for Frankenstein with Paul Morrissey and Andy Warhol. And that's how Gus got to know his work. And then My Own Private Idaho was his first film in America. So so he loved it. But then he wouldn't come back for. We wanted him to come back because his character is also in A Blue Funk. And he kept making excuses. I guess he's in like Scooby Doo 3 or something. He needed to learn his lines from Scooby Doo 3. So he couldn't make
good excuse.
So we got former teachers from Disney to play the part.
We're going to go late here. I'm going to try and get as many of these questions as I can. You.